So that's a very distinguishing feature of it. And when Stan Williams and his colleagues at HP made this device, a solid-state device here, they couldn't figure out in the beginning what this one was. They figured you know, this sort of a characteristic, but didn't know because they couldn't explain in terms of resistor, inductor, capacitor. And then they later found out the paper that jointly published by Leon Chua and myself and Leon Chua's original paper. And then they said, ah, this is a missing membrista found. So they published in Nature in 2008. And since then, it really has sort of exploded. So people are still doing lots of research on this one. And the characteristic of that is like forming a filament to make a connection. So this explains that very well. When it is one, there is a connection between top plate and the bottom plate. See, there's a filament. When it's open, yeah, that's zero. So resistance is high, resistance is low. And in other material, chalcogenide or some metal anode, this is you know, this is like the vacancy is all the way, so this can be conducting. This is not all the way, so this is non-conducting. This is a very well arrayed, so this is a conducting, non-conducting type of thing. So the Ryan Vasso, he's a professor in Aachen, he declared that there is a big class of memristive devices. The nanomechanical memory, phase change memory, thermochemical effect, valence change effect, electrochemical metallization cell, all this he declared as all memristive in nature. It's called the redox-based switching phenomena, especially in the red column there. So the class is very broad, actually. So phase change memory, RRAM, this is all kind of a memory stuff in that regard. This is, you probably know that if you do neural network, Professor Bernard Widrow at Stanford University, in maybe 2010 or 11, I gave a lecture in Silicon Valley, and Bernard came to that lecture. He brought this box. If you look at it, it's a 4x4 array. There's a 16 device array, which he called the memristor. See, a lot of good things, even including invention of a transistor. Some people say that under the sky, nothing is new. Even then, if you go back to history, you know, people made us some kind of transistor concept, at least, many, many years back. Memristor is like a memristor. Memory resistor. He found out in the early days, but wasn't based on chemical tube. Like, if Chips Gosby is a chemical engineer. So chemical tube, but it's a three terminal, just like a vacuum tube. And he could change the resistance by controlling the third terminal. So he has an anode and then cathode and then controlling terminal. That was a chemical tube he made with his PhD student Ted Hoff. I earlier mentioned Intel, Ted Hoff. So, it's Ted, what is Ted Hoff? Yeah, see? So, Ted Hoff here. So, they have Adalina, this device doing some optimization. That time, Bernard said the few devices went bad, but still was functioning very, very, you know, properly for optimization problem and so on. So in fact, at that time, Ted Hoff joined the Intel to make a solid state memristor. He couldn't make it, and then was assigned to develop microprocessor chip. It's a three-terminal chemical tube was a memristor. Which is different from Leo Chua's two-terminal memristor. But it's a similar concept, in a sense. And the interesting thing is that he called it memory resistor as well, and the memristor. And Leon, he called it memristor.
So people have done some analysis. This technology is not mature.
If you look at this technology in terms of packing density, which is important, energy per bit, read time, write time, how long data can be retained, endurance, and so on, this stuff looks very, very good.
So HP made an announcement they will have a mass production of a memristor with a Hynix. They still haven't done that. The production is something else. So
this is some application. Actually, some machine like a poster apply the memristor
in some analog circuit. This is one of the paper
cited very highly. So
you can program this resistance with this. So you know the very adaptive amplifier.
The voltage gain amplifier can be made, and then right hand side is the potential application of a neural network using memristor array and this load device, and then threshold
so can be applied for neuromorphic computing application, neural network type of thing.
So this shows some digital application. It has a high resistance state and a low resistance state, so you can switch between two different resistance state, so it can be used as a memory as well as a logic element, for instance. So this shows how you can make logic NAND gate, NOR gate, or even exclusive OR gate, and then you can make some pattern search type of thing using this NAND device. And this shows one application. You sort of code and then give input California, and then it shows a match in this type of a circuit.
The other thing is you can have a FPGA.
This is one of the early work by Pierre.
He is now on the faculty at the University of Utah
under the guidance of Manny Dimitrilli. Some of you may know at the EPFM, he was formerly at Stanford. They
configured some FPGA using a memristor type of thing.
It shows that you can reduce area, and you can,
with a higher packing density, you can have a shorter wiring,
and thus it can be faster, for instance. So you can have an area reduction, and you can have a delay reduction, you can compare with the SRAM and resistive RAM in terms of delay and so on. So there's a potential benefit by using memristors. That's why there's so much emphasis on research.
So a lot of university people are looking into it. So you know, as evidence, when I published this one in 1976, no citation at all until 2008, and now today has more than 1,400 citations on this paper. That shows that many people are interested in applying memristor theory and applications. One of the, in my view, also exciting thing is really brain science. Earlier we had a deep mind beating Is et al. In Go game, I think the more progress can be made if we understand how we think, how our brain functions, and if we make some non-Neumann type of architecture using new device technology, there can be more progress. So there are a lot of interesting books on this topic. There's lots of brain initiative, including in Europe, in EPFL, and then likewise in the US, although funding level is not as severe as Europe type of thing. The other interesting thing is using biosensor and the AI type of a thing, the human-robot interaction. The interesting thing is that this person is a her at his undergraduate at MIT. He was a mountain climber. When he was a teenager, he didn't care anything but mountain climbing. And that was his, really a hobby, and he was really dedicated. He did too many and got into big accident. He had to amputate both legs. He lost both legs due to accident.
He cried and almost gave up.
And one day he woke up and he said, I have to do something.
And indeed, now he has developed a robot. That's his robot, a leg.
He speaks at in Davos and other meetings. You cannot tell whether he has an amputated leg.
He says he can do mountain climbing even better because he can stretch his leg and
do a jump and
so on.
Just wonderful. He says he's a wearable robot. Old lady couldn't walk, but if they wear his maybe $5,000 robot, they feel much better. And based on his muscle movement and all that, they can do a lot.